Smoky Mountain Wrestling. I'm Jim Ross alongside Les Thatcher. Ladies and gentlemen, what a great broadcast we have for you this week. And what a main event. Ricky Morton one-on-one with New Jack of the Gangsters.
That's right. This has escalated down to a single match. And I'm not sure the building's going to hold it, Jim. It's going to be quite a battle.
It's going to be volatile indeed. Plus, Bruiser Bedlam is here. And I'll have a very special confrontation this week as well.
That's right. On confrontation, Jim will be talking to Cactus Jack, Boo Bradley, and Tammy Fitch. And Cactus Jack, in a humanitarian effort, is trying to get control of Boo Bradley.
Well, it'll be interesting to say the least. Plus, ladies and gentlemen, in the Beat the Champ, we've got a very special challenge for the champion, Scott Studd.
That's right. It's going to be Brian Anderson coming out to take on the champ. And this should be a great match between two fine young wrestlers.
And Les, I can't wait for you to tell the fans. I know you've got big news on Ron Wright.
Wow, that's right. News is the word, and big, Jim. Ron Wright, because of what happened here last week with Jim Cornette and that leather strap, Ron Wright, bad hip and all, is coming out of retirement. He wants to put on the shoes one more time with James E. Cornette.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, there's a big reason behind this. Let us take you back to last week's broadcast. Here's what transpired in one of the most shocking incidents in Smoky Mountain Wrestling history.
With us, an assist, an under-the-table assist, if you will. But I guess you got to do what you got to do. I can't condone his actions, but they were effective.
And nothing that Cornette himself wouldn't have done had he the chance.
Well,
Jim,
you're right about that. Ron Wright pulled some sort of foreign object out of his pants there. It looked like a blackjack or something. I couldn't see it. He dimmed the running lights of Bruiser Bedlam, and now Bedlam's got to take five lashes, and so does James E. Cornette.
And look at Mr. Cornette start to squirm as they try to hook the cuffs here on the big Bruiser in the corner. He'll take the first five, and I'd say they better put security on the doors, Jim, because Cornette may try to head south for the winner.
Cornette may have a seizure. He may have to have mouth-to-mouth. I don't know anybody here that would volunteer.
I don't either.
And Bruiser Bedlam has been handcuffed to the corner as the stipulations. They all agree to these terms. You're going to be able to hear them. There's one, ladies and gentlemen. There's two. The Smoky Mountain champion getting a small measure of revenge here, lashing at the back, that huge back of Bruiser Bedlam. And Jim Cornette's time is coming.
DWB is relishing each and every
now,
shot, too.
Jim Cornette.
All right, look here. Stripping the jacket off Cornette.
By the dirty white boy.
And Ron Wright getting ready to pull him down.
Well, they're going to handcuff Cornette. Now the referee taking the handcuffs off of Bruiser Bedlam. And then they will, just as they did Bruiser, handcuff James E. Cornette. Ron Wright trying to, he wants to see some hide here.
Yes, he does. He's trying to bear that back, and he's going to do it.
Cornette has not been in the woodshed in a long, long time. Maybe never.
And it's been long overdue, no doubt.
The mama's boy is going to get what he deserves here. Cornette now, head first into the turnbuckle.
He's got him hung up. Let's see him put the cuffs on him. And Jim Cornette is about to receive
his... Oh, a cheap shot. Bruiser Bedlam with a cheap shot on Ron Wright.
The white boy back at him and nails Bedlam and drops him here. But Cornette hasn't been secured. And keep an eye on him, Jim.
Cornette has thrown powder or something in the face, I think, of Ron Wright. And down the face of the dirty white boy. There was a cheap shot by Bruiser Bedlam that took down the veteran, Ron Wright. The
down goes Mark Caritas, yes.
Cornette stomping away at the dirty white boy.
And right White Boy and Wright are both incapacitated, and Cornette is going to take full advantage. What are they going after here? He's going to cuff the White Boy. Look at Cornette start on Ron Wright.
Cornette with a cheap shot on Ron Wright. The referee is out of it. Bruiser Bedlam is handcuffing the Smoky Mountain champion, the Dirty White Boy, over here on the rope. The Dirty White Boy is helpless. He has been handcuffed in the corner. Ron Wright has been assaulted. He's
Cornette
lying in the ring
has
helpless.
The strap. Cornette has the strap.
Cornette's got that belt.
Oh, no. He's going after Wright with it.
Cornette is whipping Ron Wright with that belt.
Jim, I'm going to tell you right now, he better put him down to stay. He don't want no part of Ron Wright if he comes up.
Ron Wright is being humiliated. The legend, the Smoky Mountain legend, Ron Wright, being humiliated as he has never been in his entire career.
And here, look here.
Oh, help is on the way. We got to get out of here.
I'm Cornette. You punk, you jerk. I may not be able to wrestle some of these top men around here. I've had a hip implant and I've had a shoulder implant. But let me tell you something, you little pudgy bellied. I can't say what I want to say, but you know what I mean. mean. I don't care what I'm going to do. I'm going to get you in a match some way. I'll have some commissioner, what his name, to get you in that ring with me. And I guarantee you, if Tony Whiteboy has to roll me out in a wheelchair, help me in the ring on crutches, I'm going to tear your head off, and they'll take you out of there for the hospital your last trip, jerk.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, there you see exactly what transpired. You hear their comments last week. It was certainly an emotional time for you. You've had some time to think about it. What are your thoughts now?
Well, we've had a lot of time to think about it, and what we've thought of is we've talked to the commissioners, the board of directors, and Thanksgiving Thunder, the matchup will be Jim Cornette, Bruiser Bedlam will be stepping in the ring against myself and Mr. Ron Wright. Now, not only is Thanksgiving Thunder, because that match has been signed, a great moment, but it's also great for me because a man that I've looked up to for a long, long time, ever since I was a child, think of him as my own father, is going to be in the ring with me as my tag team partner. And Ron, I promise you, I will take care of Bruiser Bedlam and leave Jim Cornette all to you. And if Jim Cornette tries to break and run out of that building, I will personally run him down, drag his sorry butt back to the ring, and hand him to you.
Appreciate that, brother. Now, let me tell you something, Cornette. I've never looked so forward to anything in my life as this match coming up. I tell you what, I'm going to call this Thanksgiving week. I'm going to call it the Thanksgiving week feast for Ron Wright, because I'm not going to eat no turkey all week. I'm going to annihilate the man down there. I'll tell you, little droopy drawered, puny-looking, pus-bellied, potato muscled idiot, you, when I get through with you, your own mama's not going to recognize you. You'll load up in an ambulance and they can take you out of there, because whatever the hell it takes to do, I'm going to get down there and rub your nose in the mat and break your face all over that number 12 fist, and me and the dirty white boy's going to walk out of there two happy men. You can take out to the bank and bank on it, brother.
It sounds to me like somebody's going to get a good old-fashioned East Tennessee dog whooping.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, what a matchup that will be at Thanksgiving Thunder. We've got action for you. Don't you go away.
For the Beat the Champ TV title, introducing the champion, weighing 224 pounds from Atlanta, GA, Scott Studd.
Scott Studd making his second defense of the television championship and coming to the ring with no fanfare as far as elaborate music is concerned, his ring attire is concerned, is the challenger this week, the undefeated Bryan Anderson, and of course his dad, the legendary Ole Anderson, at ringside.
Ladies and gentlemen, introducing the challenger, escorted to the ring by his father, Ole Anderson, weighing 250 pounds from Minnesota, Bryan Anderson.
Bryan Anderson, the second-generation star, making his first title challenge here, at least in my recollection, Les, here in Smoky Mountain Wrestling. There's the bell, and we're ready to go.
Yes, sir, this should be a good one. Scott Studd with the second defense of the Beat the Champ title. And Bryan Anderson, they go collar and elbow. And you know, as you mentioned, the no-frills Anderson, even the second generation. This is the 90s, not the 60s. But this could be Ole, just so many years younger. And it's amazing to me every time I watch this young man. He hooks up, cinches up on that headlock. And look at Studd, try to power out and reverse it. Let's see if he can do that, Jim.
It was 2 weeks ago we saw Bryan Anderson the first time here on Smoky Mountain Wrestling. He won that match convincingly with a submission. That is seems to be his forte. Collar elbow tie-up, nice leverage go behind there by Scott Studd, the reigning Smoky Mountain television champion in the hammerlock. Good drop to hold. Counter move by Bryan Anderson as we saw those steel blue eyes from the master Ole Anderson at ringside.
And I've only seen those too many times up close, Jim. They are piercing. This man is a mental wrestler. Ole, as braggadocious and aggressive as he always was, still wrestled you with his mind. And
I think
Bryan has the same style.
Bryan in the ropes, and referee called the bell. He caught Studd napping there.
And Stud counters. Good arm drag takeover, nice and deep. Gets the more powerful man off his feet. You know, I'll tell you something. Thanksgiving Thunder is shaping up to be one of the most blockbuster lineups of all time anywhere. We know that the Rock and Roll Express is going to take on the Gangsters in that ghetto street fight. We know that, of course, Abdul the Butcher will meet Bob Armstrong.
We certainly do. And, of course, you're talking about Tracy Smothers, Brian Anderson, no time limit.
They could go all night long as far as that's concerned. Good wrist lock applied there by Scott Studd. I'll tell you something. The impressive young Brian Anderson best keep his focus on this title match, and I'm sure that he will, and not digress to Tracy Smothers in that no time limit affair, because Scott Studd has the quickness and the technique to beat anybody here in Smoky Mountain Wrestling, including young Mr. Anderson.
Yes, he does. Both men wrestling well here. It's a good mental chess game.
Oh, good snap takeover.
Yes, yes, very good.
I remember watching Superstation TBS with my mentor, the Dean Gordon Solik, interviewing Ole Anderson many, many times back in the 70s and the 80s. Ole had a lot of confrontations with the likes of Wahoo McDaniel, Paul Jones, Rowdy Roddy Piper, Thunderbolt Patterson, Mr. Wrestling 1 and 2, and the list goes on and on. He is legitimately known in the sport as one of the real tough, tough men ever to lace up boots. It looks like, Les, his son is much cut out of the same mold.
Oh, it's amazing, Jim. Yes, exactly. I mean, I see Ole at every move of the young Brian in that ring. Right there, Stud dropping on the arm, and Stud going to work on the arm.
Pulling a page out of the Minnesota Wrecking Crew playbook, as he, young Stud, is focusing on one body part. That was the mark of that great tag team. I don't think I ever saw a better well-oiled, better operating tag team than Gene and Ole Anderson. And look at young Mr. Bryant Anderson and his high threshold of pain. Like father, like son here.
So much like him. As Stud taking it there over the top rope. Brian right back on him. Look at that cross face at him. He'll never beat him that way, but he's going to wear him down eventually and moves right back in on him every time the referee opens up for him. Watch here. Brian takes him cross ring. Elbow. Good shot,
yeah,
Jim.
Very well placed. He had a wide base going for the cover right here. 1-2. Great balance displayed there by Brian Anderson. You know, there's been a lot of great second-generation stars in wrestling. I think of Terry and Dory Funk comes first and foremost to my mind. Of course, Dusty and Dustin Rhodes, but Brian Anderson is certainly as close to being cloned after his father as any of these athletes that I mentioned.
You are exactly right. And, of course, Dad, watching this.
There's the quickness of Scott Studd there, Les.
Good move by Studd. As he goes to that top rope, he looks like he's going to try and finish him. Oh!
He took a chance there with that drop kick and came down hard on his lower back. And Brian Anderson, trying to take advantage of it, has him upside down and running shoulder breaker, trying to dislocate the shoulder.
He's going for that arm now, Jim. Look
at
him.
He's got that wide base. He's ripping at the arm. He's trying to tear it. And Scott Studd has given it up. And we've got a new television champion.
And new Beat the Champ TV title holder, Bryant Anderson.
Well, Tracy Smothers, you best beware. This kid is for real.
He is on fire, Jim, and he proved it right now as he beat Scott Studd. He is the new television champion.
And now, ladies and gentlemen, here is how exactly you can sponsor Smoky Mountain Wrestling in your hometown.
You'd like to raise money for your school, club, or civic organization, and you'd like to see the excitement of Smoky Mountain Wrestling live in your hometown, this message is for you. High school and college athletic departments, sports teams, police and fire departments, JCs, civic groups, or any group wishing to raise money can bring the stars of Smoky Mountain Wrestling to town for a night of action and receive a portion of the receipt. Write to us or call Sandy Scott at 703-989-6819. Smoky Mountain Wrestling and your civic group, an unbeatable tag team.
And we are back here, ladies and gentlemen, the new Beat the Champ television champion, Brian Anderson. I've got to say, I was very, very impressed with that victory there.
Well, I'm not surprised you're very impressed. 3 weeks, I'm already a champion here. The only reason it took me that long is I didn't get a title shot until now.
Well, Ole, I'll tell you something. This is quite a prodigy here.
You see an Anderson in this kid or what?
Absolutely.
I'll tell you what, wrestling, that's what wins around here is wrestling. And Tracy, Hey, we haven't forgotten you. I hope you've been watching, because if you have, you're going to see just exactly what's going to be your future. When Bryant gets that arm hold on you, when he gets that backbreaker on you,
right,
you're going to find out what it's like.
What do you tell him?
You draw any names you want, and I hope they draw you, Tracy Smothers.
Well, I think you can tell him yourself, because he's right here right now. Now, hold on now, gentlemen. Let's keep our composure here.
Just get back a little bit.
Let's get a little order here. It's no time limit, Tracy. Get right in here. It's no time limit. It's signed.
First of all, you ain't never got to call me no boy. And second of all, that's a good win, man. You're the TV champion, and we done went over this before. You ain't got to sit out here and dog me while I'm back in the back. Hey, we can have our match anytime. No time limit.
You say anything you want. I'll admit it. You might beat me on the golf course, Tracy, but you step in that wrestling ring with me, it's going to be another story.
Is that right? Okay, hot shot. Hey, like I said, anytime you want to get it on, I'm your Huckleberry. No time limit, and I'm a sportsman, like I said. And if you're good enough to beat me, and I don't think you are, I'll shake your hand. But I don't think you're even going to get the chance.
Tracy, I got nothing to say to that. When I was in college, they didn't make me shake hands. But right now, I don't have to, Tracy. You're going to find out what I'm all about.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, that match has been signed. No time limit. The new television champion, Brian Anderson. His confrontation pending with Tracy Smothers, and we'll be right back.
Now you can own the greatest wrestling card of all time on videotape. It's the Night of the Legends. Join the sellout crowd in Knoxville for all the action and the memories. Road Warrior Hawk, the Funk Brothers, the Heavenly Bodies, Dick Slater and Bob Orton, Ronnie Garvin and the Stomper, Freebird Terry Gordy, Bob Armstrong, the Rock and Roll Express, Dirty White Boy, and more. Plus the Knoxville Wrestling Hall of Fame ceremony with the Legends. Profiles and interviews not seen on TV. Commentary by Jim Ross and Les Thatcher. This is the complete card. All matches uncut. Order now. You'll receive a free souvenir program from the Night of Legends with rare photos and profiles. Each tape set comes in library cases suitable for storage. You'll receive a free catalog on other SMW videotapes, two VHS tapes, almost 4 hours of action in library cases, plus a free program and free catalog. And we pay the postage. Send $29.95 in check or money order to Smoky Mountain Wrestling, P.O. Box 1279, Morristown, Tennessee, 37816. Relive the memories.
Ladies and gentlemen, we are back here with Bob Armstrong, and as everybody knows, during Thanksgiving Thunder, it will be one-on-one, Bob Armstrong and Abdullah the Butcher. You've had some time to think about this situation. I'd like to get your comments, but right now, ladies and gentlemen, let's take a look, courtesy of videotape, of the one and only bad man from the Sudan, Abdullah the Butcher.
Abdullah the Butcher is one of the most feared and hated men in professional wrestling. He has been a top attraction and main event star in every promotion around the world for over two decades. Abdullah the Butcher has not been defeated by pinfall in this country in over 10 years. Yet Abdullah is seldom seen in the United States these days and never on television, because in every match he lives up to his name, the Butcher. Abdullah the Butcher has left a trail of broken bodies, battered opponents, and fines and suspensions around the world. He has been involved in some of the bloodiest, most violent matches in wrestling history. So unpredictable, so dangerous is the madman from the Sudan that promotions such as the WWF or WCW won't deal with him. They can't take the risk. Now Jim Cornette is bringing the Butcher to Smoky Mountain Wrestling to represent him in the final conflict at Thanksgiving Thunder. Never again will Jim Cornette or any of his men be allowed to battle the Bullet, and Cornette has chosen the Butcher as his ace in the hole. If Bullet Bob can defeat the Butcher, Cornette will be forced to kiss Armstrong's feet. But if Abdullah butchers the Bullet, Bob must leave Smoky Mountain Wrestling forever. There must be a winner, and Jim Cornette has bet the farm on the nearly 500-pound monster known as the Butcher.
I'll tell you, you know what you're in for now. You know exactly what faces you now. I thought when Cornette was going to get a partner, it may be a Terry Funk or maybe somebody like that, a Kevin Sullivan. I didn't know. But I never dreamed it would be Abdullah the Butcher. What are your thoughts on it?
They're exactly like your thoughts, Jim. I never dreamed of it either. You know, I've had a good run going here. I beat everybody who's brought in, and I just had a good run going. I thought, well, I can do it all, but I never thought about Abdullah the Butcher. What do you do with a man that weighs 400 to 450 pounds that's just a raging bull from the Sudan who don't stop till you're trampled half to death? And you know, the more I thought about this, I thought, if I can just keep one thought in my mind, if I can keep just one thought in my mind, Jim Cornette, that if I find some way to get by Abdullah the Butcher, you have got to crawl across the ring in front of thousands of people and kiss my ever-loving feet, boy. If I can keep that in my head on Thanksgiving, you'll be the biggest turkey of them all. Because when I got that in my mind and the people are behind me, baby, we're going to be thinking of things to do that Abdullah the Butcher. He can't do it all. There's got to be a weakness somewhere. And if there is, I'll find it. Because kissing my feet is worth more than a cool $1 million to me, Jim Cornette. That'll be the downfall of you forever. Thanksgiving thunder is going to be a thunderclap heard round the world. Kiss my feet. Kiss my ever-loving feet.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, Bob Armstrong, Abdullah the Butcher, what a dangerous situation for Armstrong to be in. We'll have more for you. First, take a look at the Smoky Mountain Hotline.
Hi, everybody, this is Jim Ross, and now you can keep informed on all the happenings in Smoky Mountain Wrestling. It's the new Smoky Mountain Wrestling Hotline. Get news from all the federations with me, Jim Ross, and the real truth with the Louisville Slugger, Jim Cornette. Vote on the fans poll, and let Smoky Mountain Wrestling know what you think. Send a personal message to any Smoky Mountain star. Hear a schedule of live events. It's news, it's fun, it's 1-900-73-SMOKY. That's 1-900-73-SMOKY. Kids, get your parents' permission before calling. We certainly hope you'll call the Smoky Mountain Hotline, ladies and gentlemen. I've got some big information out of the state of Connecticut for you here this week in wrestling. But I want to tell you, last week we saw, Boo Bradley unleashed.
Exactly. Miss Tammy came to the desk. She was irate. There was a match going on in the ring. Sean Casey, Scott Studd, and she sicked Boo on both of them, and he took it to him.
Well, it's totally uncalled for. Here's exactly what happened.
You know, if I was nasty enough, you know, I'd send Boo Bradley in the ring to take care. You know what? I am nasty enough. Boo, stick him. Go, stick him.
Hey, what are you doing here? What, Tammy Finch has just sent Boo Bradley to the ring, and he's attacking both these young men here. Big Boo Bradley.
Tammy Finch having Bradley vent her frustrations on both Stud and John Casey.
Not with a chain. He's got that chain. Well, this is Tammy Finch's doing here at her provocation. Boo Bradley is assaulting both these young men right in the middle of this beat the chat television.
Here comes Cactus Jack.
Here comes Cactus. Cactus Jack coming to the ring. And Cactus Jack trying to get Boo Bradley off. Look at Bradley waving Cactus. Are they really soulmates? She's pulling him out of there. Oh, what a crazy situation we've got. All right, ladies and gentlemen, I'm glad I'm not wearing my milkbone underwear here with Boo Bradley. And I know you probably got a lot to say, but I have been informed by the Smoky Mountain Board of Directors to let you know that because of his actions last week, at your insistence, Mr. Chris Candido's suspension has been extended for 2 more weeks.
What? Excuse me? Who are you trying to kid? No.
Wait a minute. Let me interrupt just a moment. Miss Tammy, hold on just a moment. The director's gotten my attention, and he says that at the front office, there is a long-distance call from Chris Candido for you, and he is holding, waiting to speak with you.
He probably heard about the suspension already. He's probably furious. Oh, I gotta go calm him down.
Well, you better go talk to him. And ladies and gentlemen, we've got a special confrontation. Cactus Jack and the crazy man, Boo Bradley. Don't you go away. This is gonna be something. Man, to me, with Miss Tammy on that rather dubious phone call, if you get my drift, this is a great opportunity.
Well, I had to take whatever opportunity I could because I see a lot of mistreatment going around. Boo, you deserve better than Tammy Fitch and Chris Candido, and I'm here to present the opportunity. Where did you meet these type of people?
Well, back at home, when I was a little kid, Chris used to like have people make fun of him, and he'd give me a sandwich, and I'd go beat him up, and he's my friend, and he'd do good nice things for me. Yeah.
Where have you been living? What kind of treatment do they give you?
Oh well, when I at home, I was living in a box in an alley, but they give me a nice doghouse in the backyard of the house. But there's a hole, and it rains sometimes. I get wet.
Jim, you mean to tell me here's one of the toughest men in the world. He's living in a doghouse. He's being mistreated. He's being slapped around. Boo, do they even pay you?
Yeah. They give me money. They give me like $6 here and there.
$6.
So I can go buy like shiny playthings and stuff like that.
$6?
What about your wrestling money? What about the money you get for breaking bones? Oh. Isn't that worth something?
Yeah, I don't want to lose it. They say I'd lose the money because I'm not too smart and all. And I'm, afraid of losing money, so they hold it.
This is a sad state of affairs, I can tell you.
Jim, it's about time I step in and put an end to this financial situation, put an end to the domestic situation, and put an end to the relationship of Tammy Fitch, Chris Candido, and Boo Bradley. I'm saying, Boo, you stick out your hand to Cactus Jack, and I'll show you that there is another way, the Cactus Jack way.
It's good advice, Boo. You should take it. You should take this advice.
But Chris is my friend. Chris is my friend, and if I'm friends with you, I can't be friends with him, though. You know, and...
He's very confused, it seems like.
Jim, he shouldn't have to learn the hard way like I did. No more slaps to the face, no more indignities. You're one of the toughest wrestlers in the world. You shouldn't be out here on a chain. You shouldn't be eating Alpo. You shouldn't be living in a doghouse. You should be with Cactus Jack. Maybe we'll go for the World Tag Team Championship, and we'll show the people here some good wrestling. All you gotta do is walk away.
You got a decision to make, Boo.
But they help make my decisions for me. Because I don't know too many friends.
Wait. I hear Miss Tammy Fitch on her way.
I don't know what's going on here, but that was a phone call. And I don't know who you think you are. I told you not to talk to anybody. And I told you what would happen if you talked to somebody else other than me. Do you understand?
Hey. Boo Bradley just attacked Cactus Jack here. Boo Bradley's got that chain around Cactus Jack, taking his face first into the concrete wall. Oh my God, she told him something. Tammy, now Cactus is on top of Bradley, and Tammy Fitch is trying to, she wrecked him right in the eye. We've got a hell of a fight here, and whatever ain't nailed down is a weapon. Another hard right hand. We need some help out here. She told this man something, and Bradley exploded. They're fighting right here on this hardwood floor. This is a war between these two big 300-pounders. Wes, this is volatile here.
Jim, I don't know what happened. She whispered something in his ear, and Bradley just went off like a skyrocket. And this is it.
Cactus Jack fighting Bradley. They've got a real fight here. There's a low blow. This is a dangerous situation. Bradley stomping away at Cactus Jack. Now raking in his face. He's raking in his eyes left.
He has gone berserk, kicking at him once again. Tammy screaming instructions.
We've got to get... Here comes Brian Lee. And get these guys out of here. We get some... Oh, gosh. Ladies and gentlemen, we've got to take a break. We've got to take a break, but we'll be back. What a volatile situation.
Ladies and gentlemen, introducing at a weight of 218 pounds from Extreme, Pennsylvania, Chad Austin.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, we're trying to get it back together here after that brawl with Cactus Jack and Boo Bradley. And here comes James E. Cornette. Looks like he's wearing the latest Elton John collection. That Liberace neckwear.
I was always under the impression that his tailor was colorblind.
Don't adjust your set. And Cornette turning Bruiser Bedlam loose on Chad Austin here.
Bedlam nails him and drops Austin. And of course, Cornette, I think, should plan his time wisely. Enjoy this, Jim, because he has so many tough guys on his trail, Ron Wright, Bob Armstrong, etc., etc. I don't think I could sleep nights.
Well, just last week right here on this broadcast, we saw Cornette and Bruiser Bedlam handcuff the dirty white boy to the ring ropes with a suplex. Look at the power, the 285-pounder. And then lash, brutally, the legend Ron Wright, a man in the Knoxville Wrestling Hall of Fame, a man that amassed more votes, I understand, as the most popular wrestler of all time in this part of the United States than any other wrestler.
Hey, absolutely right, and he's coming out of retirement. He wants a piece of Jim Cornette.
Well, I'll tell you something. He's got to go through Bruiser Bedlam. It's not going to be easy. I know that the Dirty White Boy says he's going to take care of Bruiser Bedlam, but that is one tall, tall order. What a clothesline. Turn this kid inside out.
He certainly did, and young Atkins right now needs to pack it in or put it together. One of the two, Bedlam has got him. He's overpowered the young man. And Jim, I think it's just a matter of tolling the...
Oh my, running slam there. Chad Austin really planted by Bruiser Bedlam. And there's a headbutt. And that should be all. Put the kid out of his misery, will you? He's had enough. And he pulls him up. There's no reason for that. Absolutely no reason for that whatsoever. I want to tell you something. At Thanksgiving Thunder, when Jim Cornette dons those wrestling tights, which I can't wait to see, and teams the Bruiser Bedlam against the Dirty White Boy and Ron Wright, it may be the last time that we ever see Jim Cornette involved in wrestling again.
I would say a very good statement on your part, because Cornette could be in the hospital after Thanksgiving. That could be his Christmas present, a long stay at some nice, clean, sanitary hospital.
Well, he's got just some big plans for Thanksgiving. Remember, they're big. They may be 500 pounds worth of big when he brings in Abdullah the Butcher, the bad man, the carnivore, the bad man from the Sudan, and there's that stomach claw. Bruiser Bedlam's got that stomach claw, and it is over.
Ladies and gentlemen, the winner of the match, Bruiser Bedlam.
Bedlam puts Austin away with that stomach claw, and once again, the big bruise comes up the winner.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, I'll tell you something. There's a lot of big things going on the Smoky Mountain Hotline. Some big news out of the state of Connecticut. I want you to call us, 1-900-73-SMOKY. The Smoky Mountain Hotline is hot.
Take a good look. That's Ron Wright and the Dirty White Boy.
Ladies and gentlemen,
all right, ladies and gentlemen, as we mentioned, Thanksgiving Thunder is rapidly approaching, and you seem like you don't have a care in the world. This could be your last go around there.
No, it's not going to be my last go around. You see that kid in the ring right there that Bruiser Bedlam just got finished with?
I saw him.
That is Ron Wright 40 years ago, because let me tell you something, Ron Wright, I'm sick and tired of hearing about how you were the greatest wrestler in the history of Knoxville, how the Wright brothers, Ron and Don Wright, rode roughshod over all the tag teams. How that Ron Wright was the toughest, meanest old coot that ever lived. Let me tell you something right now, Ron Wright. First of all, you were a second-class wrestler, and you were a third-class fighter.
That's not true.
And there ain't no tough men in Tennessee to begin with, nor anywhere around here except for Bruiser Bedlam and the men that I manage. So the Wright brothers, and Ron Wright in particular, he beat a bunch of pansies.
We're not talking about Wilbur and Orville here. We're talking about Don and Ron, Cornette.
That's exactly right. Ron Wright beat a bunch of pansies and a bunch of sissies. He never beat nobody in his stinking life. And now he's 117 years old. When he was in school, they didn't have history. I told Ron Wright one time, I said, Ron Wright, act your age. And he died. Do you realize that?
Oh, that's really funny.
So now, Ron Wright, you want to get back in the ring? You want to relive the glory years? Well, this man right here is going to tear up the Dirty White Boy, and then I'm going to take your old, decrepit, 742-year-old Methuselah geritol-drinking carcass, and I'm going to whip you like I did before, and I'm going to break you in half, and I'm going to take that hip implant out, and I'm going to break that knee, and I'm going to send that arthritis-ridden body back to the rest home in Sunnydale where you belong, and then, the crowning achievement of my career. Bob Armstrong, you know, they say sometimes...
You better rethink this Abdullah thing. He can't be controlled.
Oh, of course he can be controlled. He can be controlled by who's got the money and who's got the food. And I got both. And you see something? Bob Armstrong about Abdullah the Butcher. He don't play no favorites. He'll slice and dice anybody just like a kitchen utensil. And they say sometimes these championship games, these close contests between two athletes or two teams of top caliber go down to the wire. So maybe it's only fitting that this has gone down to the final conflict. The last time I'll be able to send a man after Bob Armstrong is at Thanksgiving Thunder. Then I can never darken his doorstep again. And Bob Armstrong, if you beat Abdullah the Butcher, something that nobody has done, at least in this country in the past 10 years, and maybe anywhere in the world.
You're right about that.
That's how I'm exactly right, because I checked my facts out. If you beat Abdullah the Butcher, Bob Armstrong, then I gotta crawl across the ring and kiss your feet. And I would rather die, and I'm sure these people would like to see me die anyway, but I would rather die than kiss your feet, you stinking redneck, because I hate your guts, and I have since day one of Smoky Mountain Wrestling. But If Abdullah the Butcher beats Bob Armstrong, then Jim, he is gone from Smoky. No commissioner, no wrestler, he can't referee, he can't sell popcorn, and Thanksgiving Thunder is going to be Jim Cornette's crowning achievement. I'm going to destroy two legends in the same night, Ron Wright and Bob Armstrong, and I'm going to do it with a smile on my face. You know I'm more of a man than you realize. Look at that arm right there. It's as big as your, well, no, nothing's as big as your head.
I prefer not to look at any part of your anatomy. Ladies and gentlemen, I'll tell you something. It could be the final showdown for Jim Cornette, too. Don't forget that part of it, and we'll be right back.
Now you can own the greatest wrestling card of all time on videotape. It's the Night of the Legends. Join the sellout crowd in Knoxville for all the action and the memories. Road Warrior Hawk, the Funk Brothers, the Heavenly Bodies, Dick Slater and Bob Orton, Ronnie Garvin and the Stomper, Freebird Terry Gordy, Bob Armstrong, the Rock and Roll Express, Dirty White Boy, and more. Plus the Knoxville Wrestling Hall of Fame ceremony with the Legends. Profiles and interviews not seen on TV. Commentary by Jim Ross and Les Thatcher. This is the complete card. All matches uncut. Order now. You'll receive a free souvenir program from the Night of Legends with rare photos and profiles. Each tape set comes in library cases suitable for storage. You'll receive a free catalog on other SMW videotapes. Two VHS tapes, almost 4 hours of action in library cases, plus a free program and free catalog. And we pay the postage. Send $29.95 in check or money order to Smoky Mountain Wrestling, P.O. Box 1279, Morristown, Tennessee, 37816. Relive the memories.
Welcome back, everybody. Jim Ross back with you. Les Thatcher is back in the locker room. He's going to try to get a word with Cactus Jack. I understand that Brian Lee and Lance Storm are also standing by. Let's take it back to the locker room and my colleague, Les Thatcher.
Jim, I'm here in the locker room with Lance Storm, Brian Lee, and Cactus Jack. And Jack, out there on the set just moments ago, whatever Tammy Fitch whispered to Boo Bradley set him off like a crazy man.
Maybe Tammy Fitch isn't doing quite as good a job at counseling Boo Bradley as she should have. Because apparently Boo Bradley doesn't know that much about me. Well, let me inform you, I'm Cactus Jack! And soulmate or no soulmate, no one treats me like that! I've got commitments all over the world. And Brian, Lance, I know you've got contracts with Boo Bradley and Chris Candido. And I'm saying this to you as the man you had your first professional match with. Grant me one favor. I can make it to Thanksgiving Thunder, and I will be there. And I want my name on that contract. So Lance, Brian, I'm on my knees begging you. Work it out for the sake of Cactus Jack. And understand something, Boo. I harbor no hatred in my heart for you. I just want to choke you till your eyes pop out. But it's all in the name of making you a better person. I said when I started, this was the most heroic venture I've ever set out upon. No one said it'd be easy, and it sure as hell hasn't been so far. But Thanksgiving Thunder, Brian, please. Lance, I'm on my knees. Work it out for Cactus Jack. Bang, bang.
Well, quite an intriguing offer made by Cactus Jack, ladies and gentlemen, and more intrigue involving the Rock and Roll Express and the Gangstas, the Smoky Mountain Tag Team Champions. As you know, the Rock and Roll Express arrested for assault as a result of this altercation.
I called my attorney, I said, yo, I said, you got to do something. I said, we beat him. You know what I'm saying? He went out there, he said, well, I'll tell you what. I'm going to go to Smoky Mountain. He said, I told him, look, this is the deal. You done violated the game of constitutional rights. You done did what he been doing to you, you know what I'm saying? He said, now, he go to bill, and we got him. Didn't have to beat nobody. They had to kill him, you understand? Then they complained about Ring of Lord somewhere on the side of the highway, talking about he done get his car up and broke down. He got jumped on and got beat up. We didn't do it. I was at home sleeping. I ain't know nothing about it. But look who got the bell there. Look who got the bell. You know what I'm saying? I told you, man, roll down, baby, look here. We the one. You know what I'm saying? We the ones, baby.
Break it up!
Ladies and gentlemen, that altercation, as I mentioned, got the Rock and Roll Express arrested for assault. We'll see our main event, Ricky Morton and New Jack, one-on-one momentarily. Now, don't forget our 900 number question this week. Should Smoky Mountain officials allow Abdullah the Butcher to compete at Thanksgiving Thunder? Call our hotline this weekend for all those scoops. And our TV main event is next. Don't you go away.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is your TV main event, a special challenge match.
Here come the drums!
And that music can mean only one thing, ladies and gentlemen. New Jack, representing the Gangstas, he is one half of the Smoky Mountain Wrestling Tag Team Champions. He will be going one-on-one with that fireball, Ricky Morton. And I'll tell you something, Ricky Morton's had his share of bad luck. He's attacked at roadside. The Gangstas, their posse more specifically, implicated in that. And we'll tell you more about that momentarily.
Ladies and gentlemen, introducing at weight of 242 pounds.
Hey, wait a minute. There's Ricky Morton. Oh, my. Oh, oh. He has dented that steel chair right across the head of New Jack.
And got the posse two on that one, Jim. And look here, Ricky Morton is bringing a battle to him.
There's no introductions completed. New Jack's still got his title belt on. Morton's got that steel folding chair. Boom! Right across the head one more time. This match hasn't even started. This is nothing but a fight.
As far as Ricky Morton's concerned, it's almost over, and this one may spill out into the streets to batten down the hatches. It's New Jack and Ricky Morton, and Jim, this is going to be a barn burner.
Well, they talk, wait a minute, here comes Mustafa Saeed from behind. Referee's calling for the bell. I don't know why. I don't think the match has even started. Remember that ghetto street fight at Thanksgiving Thunder.
Here comes Robert Gibson to go in the fray.
Gibson in. Oh, it's breaking loose here. There goes the posse outside.
And we've got a small-scale war. It's supposed to be a single match, a challenge match between Morton and New Jack. We've got the champions and the challengers in that ring, and we've got a battle on our hands, Jim.
What hatred between these two teams. Morton and Gibson want revenge. They want their tag belts back. The dressing rooms are beginning to empty here. That young man right over the top rope. It is a real fight here. What a brawl. No wrestling. This is a street fight. This is an impromptu ghetto street fight without the weapons except for that one steel chair.
Sean Casey comes in there, pitched him out on the floor. Here comes Steve Skyfire, and let's see how long he's going to last. And this Mustafa grabs him, and out he goes. It's Gibson and Mustafa, New Jack and Morton. Here comes the member of the posse in.
New Jack has been busted open. He's bleeding like a hog. And Morton's got that chair, and he's going to break some more of that chair right down the face of New Jack. Oh, what a hell of a fight. And we are rapidly running out of time.
We have got a ring full of wrestlers, a full-scale riot, and here comes more to add to the fray, Jim.
It is a riot indeed. It is completely out of control. Blood is pouring. These men are, what a total hatred and disdain for each other. This is getting ugly. It's getting nasty.
Look at New Jack. He's ripping at Morton. New Jack bleeding profusely. Let's see what...
And the fight continues here, ladies and gentlemen.
There has been no let up, Jim. These men are pounding away. The wrestlers trying to separate them. They break free and right back at one another again. And New Jack and Morton are ripping and tearing. It's not a fight. It's not a wrestling match. They are just tearing at one another like animals, like mad dogs.
They are continuing to fight here. The locker rooms have emptied. The referee's been knocked out. Robert Gibson and Mustafa fighting. Ricky Morton trying to get back in New Jack. And it's New Jack back in Morton. Man, the blood is flowing. The tempers have risen past the boiling point.
They finally separated Gibson and Mustafa, and also separated Morton. But New Jack has lost a lot of blood. He has lost a lot of blood.
Well, they said they want a street fight. They said they want to get on street fight rules, and they are getting it here.
And in spades, they certainly are, Jim. Look here, New Jack out of the ring now. He is wandering around. I wonder if he's just dazed to the point he's not sure where he's at.
Ricky Morton outside. Ricky Morton outside. They're fighting on the floor now.
It has spilled over, and Morton Orton and New Jack. He's grabbed the belt, hit him with the head with the belt, Jim. Split him with the belt again.
Orton hits New Jack right in the face with the championship belt. Gibson in the ring. Now he's coming out. He got a right hand in. Boy, this kid is tense here.
They are trying to separate him, but to no avail. They have been unable to separate these four men. This thing has been going on, it seems like, forever now, Jim. And it doesn't seem like any of these four wrestlers have
lost. Ladies and gentlemen, we have run out of time. We'll keep our cameras rolling. We'll show you what happens right here next week. So long, everybody.